Right, so there's this thing called Benford's law, which tells you how often you should expect each of the non-zero digits to appear as the lead digit across a range of data. And I've seen a lot of discussion online saying, first of all, Benford's law is a good tool for detecting election fraud. And secondly, if you look at Biden's vote totals across the Chicago area, they do not match Benford's law. Benford's law is in the yellow and Biden's totals are the blue bars. There's no match. Whereas Trump's data looks like it matches. Well, I can confirm, first of all, no, that's actually exactly what you would expect. That's not out of order. I'll explain more in a moment. And secondly, Benford's law is not a good test for election fraud. And I quote, Benford's law is problematic at best as a forensic tool when applied to elections. I just wanted to get all of that out at the beginning. For people who only watch the first minute or two, actually this is great, although the details are very interesting and Trump's data also throws out some interesting results, as does Biden's. So let's take a closer look. First question, what is Benford's law? It's basically a statement that if you get a big range of data from the real world and you look at the lead digit of each of the values and you count up how many are ones, how many are twos, and so on, you actually get way more ones than anything else. Here's a diagram I made, and you should expect roughly 30% of all data values start in a one, 17% start with a two, and all the way down. Actually, if you link them up with a yellow line, that's the overlay that I had on the plots earlier. And of course, I want to double check this actually works because it's a bit weird. So I double checked a famous example. I went and downloaded the year 2000 stats for the populations of all 3,141 counties in the US. I plotted their lead digits and it's an almost perfect match. So Benford's law does work, which brings us to the second question. Why does Benford's law work? Why on earth would you expect so many ones? Well, let's think about some everyday possible types of data collection, like measuring things. If you were to run around the house and measure things between 0 and 2 meters long, of all the whole numbers between 1 and 200, a full 55.5% of them start with a 1. And if you were picking dates at random, just you look at random days of the year, if you look at the day in the month, 36.1% of all dates, the day of the month, starts with a 1. And you can get really into the detail of exactly how this works and how you get the plots. Other people have done a better job than me. You can check out Steve Mould's video on Numberphile from many years ago, where they explain it very nicely. And Rob Eastaway's book, How Many Socks Make a Pair, covers this in detail as well. So I'll link to both of those in the description below. But the important thing is Benford's law only holds if your data covers a range of magnitudes and the numbers are different sizes. If they're all the same size, it doesn't work. If I was measuring things between 0 and 1 meter, I wouldn't get this result. It's only because some measurements are 2 digits and some are 3 digits, we start to see this weird distribution. So you only get Benford's law in some situations. And one of the main requirements is that the data spans several orders of magnitude. And yes, Benford's law is used to detect fraud, just mainly in accounting. And it's hard to get examples of this because most forensic accountants don't want to reveal what they actually do. They refuse to go on the record, in my humble experience. There is one exception. A researcher, Mark Nigrini, realized they could get over 150,000 old taxpayer records from the year 1978. They're all from the US, they were publicly available, and they analyzed them using Benford's law to see, hypothetically, what kind of anomalies it would spot. And they didn't use the standard Benford's law, which just looks at the first digit, because Benford's law also makes statements about the second digit and indeed the pairs of first digits. So they looked at every single pair of first digits from all the numbers and then plotted their frequency against what Benford's law predicts. And here is what they found. So the first plot, these are all the lead pairs of digits for interest people have declared as an income on their tax returns. And this was something which the government at the time was very easily able to double check, and you can see what people reported almost perfectly matches Benford's law. So we assume that they're doing it honestly. And the amount of interest people earn will vary across several orders of magnitude, so we shouldn't be surprised about that. They then also looked at the income from dividends as claimed. And this was a lot harder for the government to verify. And you can see several spikes that stick out. And you think, well, what's going on there? The spikes are all multiples of 10. Big one at 50, other ones at 60, 70, 80, etc. This tends to indicate that people aren't putting down the exact value. They're estimating it, or they're rounding it. They're putting it in approximately. So those spikes just indicate people have either rounded or estimated the data because they figure the government can't check. Finally, we have people's interest expenses, not income, this is expenses. And you can see that the higher values are suppressed. And you think, well, hang on, this should follow Benford's law. What's up with that? Well, it could be fraud. It could be people not stating their interest. But actually, it's better explained by people not bothering to claim the interest as an expense if it wasn't a significant value. And so that's what causes this slight deviation from Benford's law. In general, though, you can't just look at it and say, this is fraudulent, this is not fraudulent. It's just a way of looking at a lot of data, spotting things that are unusual, and then you have to investigate, why is that unusual? What's the explanation? Could it be fraud? It's not necessarily so. Okay, let's talk Biden. Why does their data not match Benford's law when Trump's seemingly does? Well, I looked into the data that was being used in this analysis, and it's from Chicago. And in the US, each state does its election itself. And right down to the city level, it's a little bit different everywhere. And how they divide up the population changes slightly. In Chicago, they have 2,069 precincts. Now, these are clumped into wards and counties and so on. However, the data people were analyzing is from those individual just over 2,000 precincts. And if you go on to the Chicago Board of Election Commissioners website, you can actually download the total number of votes as well as the breakdown by candidate for every single precinct, all 2,069 of them. So I downloaded that data. That's how I double checked that these plots are correct. If you get the lead digits, you get exactly these. Double checked it myself. But then I looked at the sizes of the precincts, and they're picked to be roughly the same population each. So it shouldn't be that surprising when you realize they're all about the same size. The smallest one had a mere 39 votes cast in it. The biggest one had 1,655. The average, however, was about 500. It was 516, and the standard deviation is super tight. They're all clumped roughly around the middle. There are only 7 precincts which had fewer votes than 100, and there were only 20 precincts which had 1,000 or more votes, which means 98.7% of all precinct vote totals was a 3-digit number. This has got like the opposite of several orders of magnitude. Almost every precinct reported pretty much the same number of votes, and they were all smack bang in the middle of the range of 3-digit numbers. Of course, we're not going to get a Benford distribution out of this. While I had the data up, I also went through and categorized every single vote total that Biden got in 10 vote bins. I then plotted that distribution, and you can see it's basically a normal distribution and quite a tight one. That's because Biden was overwhelmingly the favorite in the Chicago area. So basically, the range of the total number of votes available in each precinct was clumped around the middle of 3-digit numbers, and Biden got a really consistent percentage of that, which is why they've got this normal distribution. And if you look at their Benford first digit results, what you're actually looking at is just a simplified version of that distribution. So given this is the distribution of the votes, which perfectly matches what we would expect from everything else we know about the area, of course that's what we're gonna get. And at the beginning of the video, I had a very short quote from Benford's law and the detection of election fraud. And if people actually read through that paper, it describes exactly this. Partway down, it says, if a competitive two-candidate race occurs in districts whose magnitude varies between 100 and 1,000, the modal first digit for each candidate's vote will not be 1 or 2, but rather 4, 5, or 6. And this is exactly what we're looking at here. The paper describes this exact situation and says how normal it is. I'll link to the paper below if you want to check it out. And actually, one other quote from the main kind of summary of the paper from the abstract. It says here, it is not simply that Benford's law occasionally judges a fraudulent election fair or a fair election fraudulent. Its success rate either way is essentially equivalent to a toss of a coin, thereby rendering it problematic at best as a forensic tool and wholly misleading at worst. In short, you can't just use Benford's law to look for fraud in elections. But Benford's law is not the only technique available. There's another one, and it gives some very interesting results. While Benford's law says that in some ranges of data, the first digits are not evenly distributed, you can also look at the last digits. If you look at the last one or two digits, depending on the data set, they should be random. They should be roughly equally likely. And when they're not, it shows you something you might want to look into. Famously, there was a restaurant, and when the government looked at the last two digits of their takings from every single day, which is basically the cents, they realized there was a spike at 40. Now, that's not because they had something priced 40. They had enough different items with different final number of cents in the price that these digits should have been random. There was a spike at 40 because the owner was making up their daily totals. They were altering them to change how much tax they would owe, and they just happened to like the number 40. Humans, bad at being random, as I have discussed many times before. And so when humans pick numbers seemingly at random, you get these weird quirks. It can be for other reasons though. An auditing company audited their own staff's expense claims. They looked at the last two digits and there was a big spike at 82. And there was a spike at 82 because one employee was claiming their breakfast on the way to work every day, which they weren't allowed to do. Can only claim breakfast when they're on the road for work purposes. And because they always went to the same cafe and they always had the same breakfast, a coffee and a specific muffin, their total always ended in 82 cents. That caused an unexpected spike in the results, and so people looked into it. So checking if the last two digits are evenly, randomly distributed is another good way to spot if something unusual is happening. So let's do it. I took the data from all 2,069 precincts in Chicago. I took the last two digits of every vote total for Biden, and I plotted the frequency here. So it's the total number for each one. It starts 00 at one end all the way across to 99 at the other. I haven't labeled everything on the bottom axis. And the height is how many of the vote totals ended in those two digits. So you can see there's a few spikes, there's a few low points. You get the idea. But is that random? Is that what we would expect? Well, I decided to compare it to the first 2,069 pairs of digits from Pi, starting with 3-1, and then 4-1, and then so on. And I wanted something random, but verifiable, because if I just say this is random data, you might think, well, is it? Maybe you searched for data which backed up the point that you're trying to make. So to be totally transparent, you can verify this. Get the first 2,069 pairs of digits in Pi and double check that that is the distribution you get. And again, it's random and it looks pretty much the same as the Biden one. It goes up, it goes down. Obviously they're not all exactly the average, which I've labeled with the yellow line there, but there's roughly as many up as down. Not surprising. Now let's have a look at the Trump vote total, and you get this. What is going on there? There's a huge spike at the bottom. Like it's like a massive tower. I'm gonna call that the Trump Tower. And that's an indication that there's something suspicious going on. Way above the average, which is actually 20 and a half, give or take. And then the higher values are correspondingly suppressed to allow for the building material for Trump Tower. So hang on, I would say if we're looking for evidence of weird election tampering, that is a ridiculous deviation from what we would expect. Well, it's a ridiculous deviation from what we would expect if we were to expect the last two digits to be random, which is actually not what we should expect. So if we go back to the distribution of the vote totals for Biden, which I did earlier, I ran the same analysis for Trump, and you get this. It's a huge spike, a full 400 of the precincts, that's roughly a fifth of them, Trump got between 10 and 19 votes. There's 202 between 20 and 29. In fact, the median point is at 60 votes. So in over half of precincts, Trump got fewer than 60 votes. In fact, 70% of Trump's vote totals were only a two-digit number. And so when I was saying the last two digits, in 70% of the cases, that's just the digits. That's just the actual total. So what you're looking at here is not a random distribution, it's the data itself, which is why we get that weird spike. So once again, these tests can be an interesting way to spot that something might be wrong, but they don't guarantee that it is. You should first of all take a closer look at the data to see what's going on. That's the moral of the story. Don't take anyone's word for it. Always verify what people are saying. They've probably got an agenda they're trying to push, which actually is kind of fine, I think. I mean, of course, every side should be championing their own cause, putting forward your best possible argument. But it's probably worth doing a quick impartial double check first, even just for your own sanity and integrity. Finally, while I have you here, I've mentioned my book, Humble Pie, a couple times. It's because in the book, I talk about Benford's Law, how it can be used as a forensic accounting tool, which is why everyone got in touch with me when Benford's Law was suddenly in the news relating to election results. That's the US cover I just went and grabbed. So you'll see that in North America. You'll see that most of the rest of the world. And Waterstones, which is a major bookseller here in the UK, like a high street shop. They have selected Humble Pie as one of the top 100 paperbacks of the year 2020. I'm super proud. Thank you so much, everyone who bought this. I thought to celebrate, I would make a video about one of the stories in the book, which I've not made a video on yet. So if you've read the book and you think there's a great story in here that I've not covered on YouTube, put it in the comments below, send me an email. I'll pick one and I'll make a celebratory video. It should be good fun. Oh, I mean, I'm saying that Waterstones picked this as one of the top 100 paperbacks of 2020. Have I made that up? Go to the website and verify. I will link to it on Waterstones below. And of course you can get signed copies on Mass Gear. Or can you? Double check for yourself.